It's now mine. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm a little bit, just a little bit overwhelmed with our worship. I was, you know, worshiping here, and I opened my eyes, and the light came right out from that lamb, and it just wept me to my knees. I was like, wow, you know, what an awesome God we have. And just, I cannot imagine what it will be like to be in heaven face to face, you know? Is that amazing to think of, isn't it? To think that we would be face to face. Such an amazing God. All right. So we've been talking since our first service about how we've been talking about the chainmail church and about how, and I think there we have our first setup here, how God was speaking to me about how the church is supposed to be like chainmail. And I said that our first step is this is us. This is us connecting to God that makes us. This makes us a good Christian. These are some of the things we're working on. This is our heart, when we give God our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. And that's the scripture verse we were coming to. And that becomes us, the first set of five in our chainmail, right? So we've been talking a little bit about who this God is that we're trying to connect to, right? First thing, we talked about how God is love, and that we have to be ready to receive his love, that he's open and he comes to us, right? And we have to be ready to receive his love, that God is love. And then we talked about how God is, well, he's a victor, right? He's the winner, right? We talked about how we have victory by connecting ourselves to God. And tonight we're going to talk about how Jesus is God. In John chapter 8, verse 59, Jesus says two words. He says, I am. He says, before Abraham was born, I am. And these two words really got people kind of upset. And the reason being is because he was referencing Moses. Remember the story of Moses, and God comes to Moses, and he's in the burning bush, right? So the bush is burning, but it's not being consumed, and the voice of God comes out to it, right? And he says, I am who I am. And Moses, like, takes off his shoes, and he's like, whew, you know? So, but Jesus uses these words. He says, before Abraham, I am. And when he said that, he was saying he was God. John chapter 1, verse 1 says, in the beginning was the Word was God, the Word was with God, God was in he was in the beginning, right? So what it's saying is that Jesus was there in the beginning. And God, and Jesus is saying, yes, I was there in the beginning, I am God. And this was something that made them quite angry. So angry that they started to pick up stones, and they wanted to stone Jesus right then and there. But Jesus just, you know, quietly slipped away, is basically what the Bible says. So they obviously were, like, probably mad. They probably started to talk to amongst another. Can you picture the scene right here, you know? And they're like, what? He's, I am? What is he saying? He's God? What? How can he be God, you know? And the next thing you know, they're like, yeah, we should stone him. Yeah, we should stone him, you know? And the next thing you know, Jesus is gone, right? In the book of John, he says, I am. He has eight declarations of himself as I am. The first one is I am. He's saying I am God. The second one, he says I am the bread of life. He says I am the light of the world. He says I am the gate. He says I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the true vine. Jesus makes these eight declarations in the book of John about who he is. And these aren't names for God. These are who he is to us. And tonight we're going to talk about how he is the bread of life. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. The Greek word is dzoe. And dzoe means actually like a lifetime. There's another word, it's suke, which means breath, right? That kind of life. But this is like a lifetime. This is forever, for eternity. Jesus says, I am the bread of a lifetime. So let's talk about when Jesus said this. If you would like to turn in your Bibles, we're going to be reading out of John chapter 6. But I am going to fill you in on what's going on ahead of time. All right, so we start in the beginning of chapter 6. I don't want to read the whole thing to you, but I am going to read a good bit of scripture to you, and I will do my best not to make it sound boring, okay? Is that a deal? Okay, so we start with John chapter 6, and in the beginning, it's Jesus is beginning to talk, and as he's talking, people are gathering, right? That's pretty commonplace with Jesus, right? So he's talking, they're gathering, so many people come, Jesus looks at them, and he sees that they're hungry, and he has compassion on them. And what happens is, he's like, we've got to feed these people, he says to his disciples. And, you know, the one guy goes and he gets some kids lunch and he's like, well, look, we got a couple of fish and a few loaves of bread, right? And Jesus is like, okay, no problem. I can work with this, right? So he takes, there's 5,000 people there, 5,000 men, there's women, there's children, so more than 5,000. And he takes the bread, and he takes the fish, and he thanks God for it, he blesses it, and he feeds that many people, thousands and thousands of people. So he does this, like, amazing miracle, right? Imagine if you're there, and you see Jesus do this amazing miracle. You're like, whoa. There will be no hungry people in the world ever now, right? Because we only need a couple loaves of bread and, you know, a few fish, right? So they're doing the, so Jesus does this miracle. He feeds the people and there's food left over and all this is going on and everybody is like amazed. They think this is, they don't even know what to think. This is incredible. And Jesus has this thought that comes into his mind that he thinks they are so like excited about the work that Jesus did, that they are going to make him king by force. So Jesus is like, that's not what I came for, right? So Jesus goes up on the mountain and his disciples get in a boat and they start to cross the lake. And then you know this story because this is where Jesus walks on the water, right? So he goes down from the mountain, he walks on the water, comes over to his disciples. They're on the other side of the lake. And that's where we're going to pick up our story. Verse 25. So all these people that are like, whew, this Jesus thing is great because he can do these wonderful miracles, have now caught up to Jesus, okay? So it says, when they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, Rabbi, when did you get here? And Jesus answered, I tell you the truth. You are looking for me, not because you saw miraculous signs, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. On him the God the Father has placed his seal of approval. So he's like, yeah, you just came because, well, I gave you something, right? You got, you know, your tummies were fed, everything was good, and that's why you came. You didn't really come for me. Then they asked him, because they must have realized, okay, this wasn't quite right. Let me try it again. Let me ask another question. Okay, so what must we do to do the works God requires? Jesus answered, the work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent. So they asked him, what miraculous sign then will you give us that we may see it and believe you? Hello, right? Okay. I mean, you can't read that and go, what? I mean, what miraculous sign? I mean, it's just, okay, anyways, we're going to go back here. What will you do? Our forefathers ate manna in the desert. As it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat. And Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth. It is not Moses who has given you this bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world. Jesus saying, me, right? Sir, they said, from now on, give us this bread. Okay. Then Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry. He who believes in me will never be thirsty. But as I told you, you have seen me, yet you still do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me will never drive away. For I have come down from heaven not to do my will, but to do the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all that he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him shall have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. Then the Jews begin to grumble. They begin to grumble because he said, I am the bread that came down from heaven. They said, is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? I was just at their house last night. No, that's not what it says. But they're like, hey, we know his mommy and daddy. Come on, right? How can he now say, I came down from heaven? Stop grumbling amongst yourselves, Jesus answered. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, they will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me. No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father. I tell you the truth, he who believes has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your forefathers, they ate manna in the desert, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and never die. I am the living bread that comes down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world. And I love how Jesus is like, they're all talking about the physical. He's trying to get them to see the spiritual need. And then he comes right back to the physical. Because he's like, you know, you want physical? I'm going to give you physical. It's my flesh. It's my blood. And then the Jews began to argue sharply amongst themselves. Again. How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Jesus said to them, I tell you the truth, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is real food and my blood is real drink. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood remains in me and I in him. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so the one who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven. Your forefathers ate manna and died, but he who feeds on this bread will live forever. And it says he said this while teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. And then if you have a Bible where it has a caption for the next portion of the text, it says, many disciples deserted him. I find that kind of amazing, honestly. Jesus is always bringing people to him, right? People are always gathering around, but there was something in this teaching that people just were not willing to accept. So Jesus is our bread of a lifetime. He is our daily bread. He is the spiritual bread for our souls. He sustains us, right? He nourishes us. He delivers us. He daily attends to all of our needs. He gives us what we need to do his work, to live the life that he has called us to. And not only does he just give us a life, he gives us an abundant life, the Bible says. Unlike manna, which had to fall every day, because if you tried to keep it past a day, it would rot. Jesus is the bread of a lifetime. He never goes bad. He never fails to do what he says he is going to do. And we can depend on him always for everything and fully. Jesus is not just all that we need. He is everything that we need. And he says, unlike those tasteless flakes of manna that those people ate and died, you can partake of my flesh and blood and live forever. Those flakes were nothing compared to what I have to give you. But despite having this wonderful bread of a lifetime that Jesus offers us, many of us are still a bit malnourished, right? We could have everything, yet we live this malnourished life. Many people left. They did not have the stomach for what Jesus was saying. They wanted to satisfy their hunger, but they had no appetite. Hunger is this. Hunger is your need for food. Appetite, that is your desire for food. After you've fed your stomach, your appetite is what keeps you going. Your appetite is what makes you take that second, third, and maybe fourth slice of pizza, Jonathan. Because I've been around you long enough to know, right? That's your appetite. You're not really that hungry, right? Yeah. Okay, so appetite is what makes us go for the chocolate cake, right? It's not really hunger. I mean, by the time you get to dessert, you're not hungry, right? So appetite is what keeps us going after our hunger has been filled. We fill our hunger and we feed our appetite. So we're going to talk about what we're feeding today. Hunger you cannot control. When you are hungry, your stomach growls, you can't stop it, you are absolutely hungry. I shared with you before that I'm a type 1 diabetic. Now, in the type 1 diabetic community, we joke about this. Because what happens is, you know, I take a synthetic form of insulin. And if I don't eat enough food, the insulin works and my blood sugar gets really low. And so we joke about the fact about how much you'll actually eat when your blood sugar is low. Far beyond your hunger, trust me. Because what happens is that your body has this life-saving mechanism, because if I don't eat, I will die. So there goes the refrigerator. I'm not joking. No, I've gotten better at it. But I mean, there's a lot of jokes about, like, you know, people will post pictures. I ate all this because I woke at 3 a.m. and my blood sugar was 40. You know, because this is what happens. There's like a physiological or physical response that your body has when it's hungry. It's a need to survive. But your appetite you can control. You can learn to suppress your appetite. It's something that you can actually develop and grow. And it's actually a learned behavior. Similarly, with our souls, we have a hunger for God. We all have it deep in our hearts. It is our innate desire to get to know our Creator. Everybody has it. It's what makes an otherwise atheist cry out when they reach something that's going to take their life. It's why we see in the movies people start to pray out the Lord's Prayer, right? That normally don't even attend church, but this is the only prayer they know, and, you know, they hope God hears them. Right? That's our hunger. We have a real need in our souls. And when things go wrong and when things go crazy, it's what makes us come back to God when everything is just falling apart in our lives. Anybody been there? Everything falling apart, and where do you go? I got nothing else. I love it. All I can do is pray. Yeah. We can pray, but it's not the end of the line. It's the beginning of the line. But, you know, we get there. You know, we all have this hunger for God, whether we want to admit it or not. But our appetite for God, well, that's a little different story. Our appetite for God. Oh, there goes some of my Bible. I read my Bible. It's just why it's always falling apart. I'm going to put it in a safe place.
What'd you say?
No. Yes, I have to. I'm always losing Exodus. It's just in Genesis. They're just always jumping out of my Bible. Anyways. But your appetite, it is a different story. Your appetite for God, this bread of a lifetime that we're talking about, it is developed. We control it. We control our desire for God. Not our hunger. but our desire. Appetite is a craving that exists in the absence of hunger. It's what makes us go to church when everything is okay. It's what makes us follow God when things are great and when things are not. It's what makes us get up at 4 a.m. to read our Bible and pray, or whenever it is that you might do that. It's what makes us maybe seek out Christian music over secular music because we want to have more of God in our lives. It's what makes us want to turn off some of the things that Hollywood wants to give us and turn on some of the inspiring things that are available out there. You see, that is our appetite for God. Ever really desire food? All right, I'm going to ask you guys a question. Pastor Debbie, what is your absolute favorite food that you could just, right now, if it was placed in front of you, you would eat it? Oh, pistachio pudding. I love pistachio too. See, we are soul sisters. What's your absolute favorite food? Oh, lasagna. Oh, good Italian lasagna. Oh, come on, give me some favorite foods. Chips. Any kind? Barbecue? Any kind of chips. What's your favorite food? Crab legs. Wow. What's your favorite food? Chocolate chip cookies. Yeah, we could sit down and down those. Yeah. No. What's your favorite food, Mike? Chinese food. Oh, some General So's or any Chinese food. Okay. What's your favorite food? Oh, no, you did not say that. Wow, yes. Steve, what's your favorite food? Anything. If you could have anything right now, what would you have? Potato soup. That sounds very nice and warm on this cold day. Somebody needs to make Steve some potato soup. But you know, so you know what it's like to have really a desire for food. You might not be hungry, but you're going to eat it anyways, right? I have a craving right now. It's for French macaroons. Okay, so let me describe. Do you love those? Okay, so 2 years ago, Jax and I went to New York City. We have a national trade show in, I guess it was March probably that year, in New York City. And we went to the Bouchon Bakery. Doesn't that sound good? Bouchon Bakery. And at the Bouchon Bakery, they had French macaroons. Okay, now I have to tell you, at this point, I had never had a French macaroon in my life. But I saw it. And the only macaroons I've ever had in my life were coconut ones, and I don't like coconut. So the guy with a very heavy French accent, which I won't do because I'm not good with accents, I was like, does it have coconut? He goes, no coconut. And I was like, okay. So I was like, okay, we'll get it. So we get one French macaroon, Jax and I, pistachio French macaroon. And we're walking down through New York City, and we started to get a little hungry, right? Then we opened, my blood sugar got low. I was getting a little hungry. We open up the bag, and we split the one French macaroon, right? It was amazing. I mean, it was absolutely, if you've never had a French macaroon, you have to have one. They're like crunchy on the outside, gooey on the inside. They're amazing. They're like so awesome and so wonderful. So we had one, and we split it, and immediately I had a little bite, and I thought, oh, I should have gotten more. Right? Ever been there? I should have gotten more. And we didn't have time to go back and get more because we were leaving in the morning and it was late and they were already closed. And so I waited a whole year for another French macaroon from the Bouchon Bakery. So last year, I went to the Bouchon Bakery, okay? And we bought a lot of French macaroons, okay? And we brought them back, right? Well, we brought you guys some back too, didn't we? Yeah, we wanted to share how amazingly good they were, right? Were they good? Yeah, okay. So we brought back the French macaroons from the Bouchon Bakery. And in a couple weeks, I'm going back to New York City. Guess what I'm getting? A French macaroon from a Bouchon Bakery, and probably the pistachio, because that was probably my favorite for sure. So right now, I have this craving and this desire. I'm not hungry. I mean, I just ate some before we came in here, but I have an appetite. I mean, if God went, boop, there it is, I'm telling you what, I would down that before anybody else had the chance. All right? So let's talk about our appetite for this bread of a lifetime that Jesus is calling himself. Obviously, the bread is good, right? The problem lies with our desire to consume it past being hungry. So I want to talk about a few things that decrease your appetite. Stress will decrease your appetite. Sadness will decrease your appetite. Boredom will decrease your appetite. And I'm going to add one more in here that's more of a spiritual one. But sin will decrease your appetite for God. I mean, if you're stressed, then you know what? You're just too busy for God, aren't you? If you're sad, you're probably not turning to God because he will comfort you in your sadness. If there's sin, then there's probably something between you and God, right? And if you're bored, I would challenge you that you probably have filled up your life with everything but God, because God is not boring. But there's a few ways we can increase our appetite, according to science, actually. One of those ways is smell. If you smell something, if you get the aroma of something, what happens? Your mouth starts to water, right? It doesn't matter if you're hungry or not. You start to prepare to receive it, because your mouth is watering and the saliva is going. Your saliva actually is the first part of digesting your food. So when you get near the aroma of something, something that smells so good, your appetite begins to increase. And it's like that. If you want your appetite for this bread of a lifetime to increase, then you need to be around the aroma and the fragrance of the presence of God. Two or three gathered together in my name, there I am in the midst of them. You know what? There's an aroma and there's a fragrance of God here tonight with us. Here when any of us who believe gather together. You see, if you want to increase your appetite for this bread of a lifetime, then you need to be in places where God is in abundance. You know what? You can't smell. I made some bread here today for our maybe you could smell it. Could you smell it coming in? I could smell it earlier. You can smell it. Yeah. Oh, could you? Because it's right up here. You could smell it. So that must have been nice. Was it frustrating because you wanted to eat it and you couldn't? But, you know, you can't smell bread breaking in the oven here at your house, can you? So if you want to be around the aroma, proximity has something to do with it, doesn't it? That's one thing we need to do to increase our appetite. Another way to increase our appetite is to exercise. If you exercise, your body will, who's exercised and been really hungry afterwards and ate all the calories you burned? Okay. Yeah. Been there. Do that. Anyways, exercise is a way to increase your metabolism, to increase your appetite. And I want to say that in the kingdom of God, exercise is very important. There's a reason why God says that there are laborers in the vineyard. There are laborers in the field. There's a reason why he says, if you put your hand to a plow, that implies work, right? You see, there's exercise in the kingdom. There's work in the kingdom. Last week, we were not here. We were away doing our ministry, one of our other ministries that we do, unconventional percussion, and we play boom whackers. And I'm going to be honest with you. We hadn't done it for several weeks, probably maybe a month. We hadn't been out places playing boom whackers. It's a slow time of year, but it's going to start getting crazy from here. And last Sunday, I'll be honest with you, I was a little bit kind of not into it. I was kind of like, okay, this is what we do, but you know, we've got this connection thing going, and this is ministry, and I really like this ministry, and maybe, you know, I don't know, and you know, but we had this on the schedule, and we got there, and I'll tell you, man, once I started going, and I saw people there wanting to see what God has and how we might be used to give that to him, my appetite for what God was going to do began to increase. My soul began to salivate for what God was going to do. And it was an amazing time. You see, if you do not have a healthy appetite for this bread of a lifetime, I want to ask you if you're doing enough work in the kingdom of God. And not just work like, here's my money. I mean, that's like I'm eating the ice cream and putting it in my mouth, and I am exercising, right? I mean, there is a place to give money in the kingdom. Don't get me wrong. We took an offering, right? So there obviously is a place for money in the kingdom, but that cannot be the only work you do in the kingdom. You got to get your hands dirty. You got to sweat a little, maybe bleed a little, helping your friends and your neighbors and those that are in need around you. You see, that's the work in the kingdom. Oh my goodness, can you think of Jesus? He was not this pristine, clean person who never got dirty, was he? I hate to break this to you, but he was probably pretty filthy. Ever think about that? We make him look really pretty nice and, you know, he was probably dirty. He probably didn't look much better than some of the people we see on the street in New York City. We got to get busy in the kingdom. We've got to do real work. Get down on your hands and knees. Work in the kingdom of God. That will increase your appetite. And your soul will begin to salivate like mine did last week. Third thing. Smell. Get in the aroma. Get close to it. Exercise, do some work in the kingdom of God, and I challenge you, find something to do. Three, don't eat alone. People who eat alone have very low appetite. So what does that mean to us as Christians in our soul? Don't eat alone. You know what? If God is doing something in your life, talk about it. Share it. Don't keep those things to yourself. We got to get out and talk about Jesus. You know, a few moments ago, I talked to you about a pistachio French macaroon, right? I talked to you about that from the Bouchon Bakery. And who would like to have one right now? Okay. All right. So you got a desire for what I was talking about. And your appetite increased. Now you're going to be disappointed because I'm going to have to bring one back for everybody, aren't I? When I go. But yeah. But anyways, so don't eat alone. You got to share Jesus. You have to talk about him with others. That's how people know about what's happening in your life. That's how they know how good he is. That's how they know how faithful he is. That's how they know everything about Jesus is because of what you say he has done in your life and how you know him and what he's meant to you. You see, we come to God with our hunger. I need you, God. I can't do this on my own. And Jesus challenges us to come with our appetite, to come with a desire for the bread of a lifetime, not the manna that falls one day, but the bread of a lifetime. Do we have a need for our problems to be fixed, or do we just desire to be with Jesus? These people had been waiting for the Messiah to come, and all they wanted was miracles, but Jesus had so much more. They were stuck in their hunger. They wanted freedom from oppression, and Jesus wanted to make them free within their oppression. They wanted miracles. They didn't want to have anything to do with suffering. And in the end, many of his disciples did not have the stomach for it. They had their hunger fixed, They had some loaves and bread. They ate till they were full, but they had no appetite for what Jesus was offering. And Jesus was offering so much more, wasn't he? I mean, he was talking about his sacrifice on the cross. This was sort of like the pre-Last Supper, you know? This is my blood. This is my flesh. This is what I have for you. And they still didn't have an appetite for it. And lack of an appetite is the reason why many of us do not come to church. Many of us do not come in a fellowship of believers today. It's the reason why we leave church on Sunday and we don't even think about God to the next Sunday. It's the reason why we leave and we don't pray until something goes wrong. It's the lack of an appetite. We fill our hunger for what we need, but we don't develop the appetite to just be with Jesus. Manna was for a day. Jesus is every day. No expiration date. He never spoils. He will always be there. And you know what that means? You can develop your appetite for Jesus now. It's not too late. His bread is still good. It is still full of life. It is still life-giving today. The question isn't, do you need Jesus? I hope you all have answered that question in your life. And I hope it was yes. A lot of times we come to that pretty quickly. The question is, do you desire Jesus? What's your appetite like? Do you crave him even after having your fill? What are you filling yourself up with? How's your appetite? Jesus says, I am the bread of life, bread of a lifetime of living eternal. Not all that we need, but everything that we need. And so today, as we examine our appetite, I want you to just think about it. If you're going to measure your appetite from 0 to 10, where are you at? If you're not at a 10 or 11, because why not, then I want to go over those three things we can do to increase our appetite again. First, do you guys remember? Be by the aroma of God. Put yourself in places where the presence of God can be found, where it is strong. Get your appetite going. Two, get busy in the kingdom. Do some work in the kingdom. If you want to know, get your appetite increased for God, let me tell you, seeing what he does in the lives of other people through your faithfulness, I'll tell you what, that makes you hungry for God. And don't eat alone. Speak out from your mouth the goodness that God has given you in your life. Speak out from your mouth the things that he has blessed you with, the things he has talked to you about, the things that his word has spoken to you about. Speak out those things to those people that are around you. And that will help increase your appetite. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, I thank you for our amazing bodies and the way that you have made them. That, Lord, you can speak through our bodies to tell us a little bit about our souls, that we can learn, that we can be hungry, and we can have an appetite. Father, help us this week to develop our appetite for you and who you are and what you are doing in this world and in our families and in our neighborhoods and in this place and all around us, Father. Help us to increase our appetite for you. Lord, help us to turn to you at every moment in every place, that when we're at the grocery store or we're in the traffic in the car and the person behind us is going really slow or whatever's going on, Father, that we are turning and consuming of this bread of a lifetime that you have for us. Father, increase our appetite. Father, make us come out for you, Lord. Let us see that our hunger isn't just being filled, but our appetite is healthy, that it is strong, that we desire you, not the things of you, but you yourself in our lives, because you provide everything just by your presence. Lord, increase that desire in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray.